Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. This is what we do to make you happy. Yeah. So today we have the top 15 most beautiful words in Spanish. Okay? So enjoy the video. Woo! Okay guys, so even though Spanish has tons and tons of very beautiful words, we have picked for you the 15 most beautiful according to us. So hopefully you will enjoy this list. And the first word that we have is mellifluo. Mellifluous. Mellifluo. Mellifluous. Sonido extremadamente dulce y delicado. Su voz es muy meliflua. Su voz es muy meliflua. Siguiente. Inefable. Ineffable. Inefable. Ineffable. Algo tan increíble que no puede ser expresado con palabras. Lo que siento por mi novia es inefable. Lo que siento por mi novia es inefable. No puede ser expresado con palabras. The next one. Sonámbulo. Sleepwalker. Sonámbulo. Sleepwalker. Persona que camina dormida. Yo de niño era sonámbulo. Yo de niño era sonámbulo. Next word. Serendipia. Serendipity. Serendipia. Serendipity. Hallazgo afortunado e inesperado que se produce cuando se busca una cosa distinta. Yo fui al aeropuerto a buscar a mi primo y por serendipia me encontré con mi actor favorito. Diego Boneta. Yo fui al aeropuerto a buscar a mi primo y por serendipia me encontré con mi actor favorito, Diego Boneta. Yeah. The next one, etéreo, ethereal, etéreo, ethereal. Extremadamente delicado y ligero, fuera de este mundo. Megara. Su aspecto frágil y etéreo la hacen un personaje muy sensual. Megara. Su aspecto frágil y etéreo la hacen un personaje muy sensual. Ademán. Jester. Ademán. Jester. Movimiento o disposición del cuerpo con el que se expresa atención, disposición o sentimiento. Él hace muchos ademanes con las manos. Él hace muchos ademanes con las manos. Nice. The next one. Iridescencia. Iridescence. Iridescencia. Iridescence. Fenómeno óptico donde el tono de la luz varía creando pequeños arcoíris. For example. Me encanta que las burbujas tengan iridiscencia. Me encanta que las burbujas tengan iridiscencia. Siguiente. Epifanía. Epiphany. Epifanía. Epiphany. Un momento de sorpresiva revelación. En mis sueños tuve una epifanía. Ahora sé mi propósito en la vida. En mis sueños tuve una epifanía. Ahora sé mi propósito en la vida. The next one. Soledad. Loneliness. Soledad. Loneliness. Carencia voluntaria o involuntaria de compañía. A veces los individuos necesitan un momento de soledad. A veces los individuos necesitan un momento de soledad. Siguiente, olvido, oblivion, which is a beautiful word even in English.
It is.
Olvido, oblivion. Acción voluntaria o involuntaria de dejar de recordar algo. Muchos cantantes caen en el olvido después de su primer éxito. Muchos cantantes caen en el olvido después de su primer éxito.
Okay, guys, so the next word is efímero. Ephemeral. Efímero. Ephemeral. Que dura poco tiempo. For example, la tristeza es efímera. La tristeza es efímera.
Mm-hmm. Next one. Elocuencia. Eloquence. Elocuencia. Eloquence. Facultad para hablar o escribir de forma eficaz para conmover, deleitar o persuadir. Ese señor habla con mucha elocuencia. Ese señor habla con mucha elocuencia.
The next one. Desenlace. Ending. Desenlace. Ending. El desenlace de ese libro no me gustó. El desenlace de ese libro no me gustó.
Okay, next one. Superfluo. Superfluous. Superfluo. Superfluous. No es necesario o que está de más. Tu comentario es superfluo. Tu comentario es superfluo. Está de más.
Next one. Inconmensurable. Immeasurable. Inconmensurable. Immeasurable. El amor que le tengo es inconmensurable. El amor que le tengo es inconmensurable.
The last one. Okay, this is an extra one because I love this word in Spanish, which is ojalá, perhaps, ojalá, perhaps. Deseo de que suceda algo. Ojalá muchas personas vean este video. Ojalá muchas personas vean este video.
That's it for today, my friends, from SpanishBowl101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please give your thumbs up and share with other learners who want to know also 15 very beautiful words in Spanish. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel, and also if you have any comment, let us know here in the comment section down below. We do read them and reply to them. So, hopefully, guys, we will see you in our upcoming video.
¡Hasta luego!
¡Hace muy calor aquí!
¡Hey, Efra! ¿Por qué estás como luchador?
¡Wow! ¡Estás mucho fuerte!
So, guys, did you spot the mistakes that we made?
In this lesson, we're going to talk about muy and mucho. The difference, when to use it and how to use it. Love? So, let's go!
Wow!
So, Spanish learners commonly have mistakes in this topic. It is very basic, okay? But it's pretty common to have mistakes here. For example, Diego es mucho trabajador, or Diego es muy trabajador. So, when do we have to use muy or mucho? Let's go to another example. Mi tía tiene muy dinero. Or, mi tía tiene mucho dinero.
Okay, guys, so although this seems a very difficult topic, it is not difficult at all. Let's just break it down so we will clarify it. And by the way, his answers should be Diego es muy trabajador and mi tía tiene mucho dinero.
Cool.
Good, very good. Now, when should we use? Let's start with muy. Muy, basically, it's an adverb. Es un adverbio. And it is placed before, okay, before an adjective or even before an adverb itself. How is that? Okay, so, you know that an adjective is something that will basically give a description, of something, right? So we can say alto, chaparro, gordo, flaco, trabajador is an adjective, okay? Astuto, inteligente, like we have many, many, many examples of adjectives. And in this case, you will use muy. It is important to notice that muy, it's unvariable. That means that it won't change at all. It will always be muy. It doesn't matter if you're describing one person. It doesn't matter if you're describing several people or if you're describing a man or a woman. Yeah. Okay, so I can say, la amiga de Efraín es muy inteligente.
Yeah.
La amiga de Efraín es muy inteligente.
O los gatos son muy peludos.
Los gatos son muy peludos.
Yeah.
That's like for the plural, okay? And we're using masculine plural. So it doesn't change muy. You just change the adjective itself, okay? And that's for highlighting like the intelligence or how much hair or fur they have.
Yeah.
Exactly. So remember, muy is placed before the adjective.
Estoy muy bueno.
Estoy muy guapo. Okay, very good. Now, muy can also be used to describe other adverbs. An adverb. Just remember that the adverbs basically modify an action. Okay, so those modify an action.
Okay.
Let's see two adverbs, for example. Despacio. Okay, they basically reply to the question how. Okay, so for example, yo hablo how despacio. Yo hablo despacio. Yo hablo despacio. However, we can also use muy and say yo hablo muy despacio. Or even I can say yo hablo muy rápido. Okay, yo hablo muy rápido, so despacio,
yo hablo rápido. Muy rápido.
Yeah, like that. Once again,
yo hablo muy rápido.
Very good. Okay, okay, very good. So, you can also modify adverbs. So, in this case, despacio and rápido are adverbs. Let's see another adverb. We can say bien or mal. These are also adverbs. Like, Ryan, me siento muy mal. Me siento muy mal. So it's how you are feeling bad. How? Bad. That's an adverb. Me siento muy mal. Or, for example. Okay, so, or for example. Efraín, tú hablas inglés muy bien.
Muchas gracias.
Good.
Yo nací en Estados Unidos.
That's not true at all. Okay, now let's see mucho. Mucho basically could be an adjective or an adverb. It depends on the word that it will modify. So if it is a noun that will modify, mucho is an adjective. And once again, it is placed before the noun. Now, it is important to notice that mucho will change its form depending on the gender, but also depending on the number of objects. That is, you have mucho, mucha, muchos, and muchas. Now, let's see some examples.
Well, yo tengo mucho dinero. Esta ciudad tiene muchos edificios. Este video tiene muchas sonrisas. Mi prima tiene mucha comida. Mi perro tiene mucho pelo.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, now, the next way for using mucho is when it becomes an adverb. And mucho becomes an adverb when it modifies an action. Now, when it modifies an action, mucho won't change. It will remain just as mucho. Okay, so you will say the verb and then mucho. Let's see some examples.
Yo leo mucho en mi tiempo libre. Yo veo mucho la televisión. Mi primo ejercita mucho su cuerpo. Nosotros trabajamos mucho a lo largo del día.
Oh, yeah, that's true. And talking about trabajo, how will you say it? Is that correct? Trabajo mucho or mucho trabajo? Well, actually, this answer was tricky because you can say both. Mm-hmm. However, when you say trabajo mucho, you are changing the verb, okay? Uh-huh. So I work a lot. However, you can say mucho trabajo because trabajo is also a noun. So you can say tengo mucho trabajo, I have a lot of work. Not that I work a lot, but that I have a lot of work, which is very different. So you can say both. Trabajo mucho or mucho trabajo, depending on what you want to convey. Okay, guys, so now it is important to notice that we cannot combine muy and mucho. We cannot put them together. So is there a way to convey that there is even more than a lot of? Yes, we have one way. And that way is by using muchísimo, which basically works as mucho. That is, that it will be modified depending on the gender, but it will also be modified depending on the number of objects that you are going to modify. Okay, So it works the same as mucho, but instead of mucho, you say muchísimo, muchísima, muchísimos, or muchísimas.
Okay.
For example.
Diego, hoy tengo muchísima energía.
Yo en realidad tengo muchísimo sueño.
Ay, pero deberíamos luchar, tengo muchísimas ganas de hacer algo.
Yo tengo muchísimos pendientes y no podemos luchar. Además, estamos terminando el video. Okay, so finally, there's an opposite. Okay, there's an opposite of mucho, which works in a similar way as mucho. And that opposite is poco. So poco could also be an adjective, but also an adverb. That is, you can modify a noun using poco, poca, pocos, and pocas. But you can also modify an action by using just poco. Yo trabajo poco, yo duermo poco, yo como poco, etc. And we also have poco means a little, okay? A little.
Yeah.
Or a few, depending on what you are going to express. But we can also say poquísimo. Poquísimo. This is not very used, but it is possible to say poquísimo. Okay, guys?
That's it for today, friends of SpanishPod101.com.
Yes. So, okay, guys. So, if you like this video, please share it with other learners. And don't forget to like, give it your thumbs up. And also, leave your comment down below and we will be reading you and also replying to you. Hopefully, guys, we will see you in our next video.
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. As you may know, he is Diego.
Yeah, and he's Efraín.
Yeah. Well, anyway, we will give you a top 5 of TV series that you must know.
Yeah.
We will guide you through drama to comedy. From drug dealers to nice people.
Yeah, sure. So, we hope that you enjoy this video.
Woo!
Okay, guys. So, if you are a fan of the TV series and want to get out of the classical Hollywood movies with your already known actors and actresses, well, you should definitely take a look into this Mexican TV series that we are sure you're going to be very engaged with. And also, they are very entertaining. So, you can find these TV series in any online streaming platform, such as Netflix. But anyways, so, and this video is going to be recorded in Spanish. So, la número uno es Club de Cuervos.
Yeah.
Si tú viste la película Nosotros los Nobles, pues bueno, esta es una excelente noticia, porque el personaje principal
también sale en Club de Cuervos. Y bueno, básicamente Club de Cuervos cuenta la historia de los hermanos Iglesias que tras la muerte de su padre luchan por la presidencia de un equipo de fútbol. Pero hay muchísimos problemas entre ellos y bueno, puedes esperar muchísima comedia y sobre todo slang mexicano.
Ok, la segunda serie que nosotros te recomendamos es Luis Miguel, la serie. Y esta es una bioserie que nos traía a todo México muy loco. Hubo incluso un fin de semana donde todo México estuvo atento de si iba a aparecer la mamá de Luis Miguel. Y ese fin de semana nos íbamos a quedar con nuevo presidente. O sea, se juntó toda la emoción.
Muchas cosas.
Esta serie habla y se centra en la figura de Luis Miguel, quien es un cantante mexicano muy sobresaliente. Pero no solo eso, también está centrándose en la desaparición y el regreso, o bueno, la búsqueda constante de la mamá de Luis Miguel. Y se desentraña una serie de cosas, entre ellas mucho drama. Calienta el sol
aquí en la playa. Ok, entonces la siguiente serie que les recomendamos es Los Simuladores. Y claro, todos en alguna ocasión de nuestra vida hemos querido contar con un equipo especial que nos pueda resolver nuestros problemas. Quizás tenemos un problema con algún jefe, con nuestros padres, con algún vecino, con cualquier persona.
Con la novia.
Con la novia también, por supuesto.
O la esposa, el esposo.
O la amante. O cualquier persona. Entonces, siempre tenemos problemas. Y bueno, Los Simuladores es una serie que se trata de cuatro socios que se encargan justamente de resolver problemas personales mediante unos actos que ellos llaman operación de simulacro. Es decir, ellos simulan ser personas para conseguir sus objetivos. Es una serie muy, muy entretenida.
La siguiente que te vamos a recomendar se llama Soy tu Fan. Y Soy tu Fan, pues está basada en otra serie que se hizo en Argentina con el mismo nombre. Y trata sobre cómo Carla García conoce a Nicolás en una cafetería. Y esta Carla, pues sigue con su vida. Nicolás se vuelve loco por ella y la empieza a seguir. Además de encontrarse con ella de coincidencia. Y ella se siente halagada, pero también acosada. Y ella aprovecha este momento en que Nicolás la sigue para que se pueda olvidar de una expareja que ella tuvo. Y bueno, desde aquí se desenredan varias historias y mucho drama, pero también comedia. Es una buena serie y te la recomendamos mucho.
Ok, so, la siguiente serie es La Casa de las Flores. Y bueno, La Casa de las Flores es una comedia negra de una familia mexicana adinerada que, pues bueno, descubren que el padre tiene un amante y entonces la amante empieza a sacar los trapos sucios de la familia y al mismo tiempo que se desarrollan algunos problemas intrafamiliares que van, por ejemplo, desde el incesto o la homosexualidad, etcétera, Rayos. Etcétera, etcétera. Es una serie muy buena que la recomendamos y, por cierto, este año se estrena la segunda temporada de esta serie.
¡Wow! Y bueno, pues nosotros sabemos que en este top dejamos muchas series mexicanas afuera y pues cabe mencionar algunas de ellas. Ingobernable con Kate del Castillo.
Sí, es muy buena. O Un Extraño Enemigo, que es de Amazon Prime y aborda la historia de un suceso histórico en México.
Claro, La Malinche, que narra todo este proceso de la conquista de México, la llegada de los españoles y cómo fue la interacción con los indígenas.
Exactamente, o también tenemos Los Héroes del Norte, que es una comedia bastante, bastante graciosa de un grupo musical que lucha por alcanzar la fama.
O María de todos los Ángeles, mi comedia mexicana favorita, sí, favorita, debí incluirla en este top, de hecho, pero bueno, ya es nuestro.
O el señor Ávila, ¿no? Que trata sobre la doble vida de una persona como asesino a sueldo, que también es muy, muy, muy interesante.
That's it for today, my friends from SpanishBall101.com.
Oh, yeah.
We hope that you have enjoyed this video, so please give it your thumbs up and share with other learners who want to know, well, some Mexican TV series.
Yeah.
And of course, if you have any comment or opinion, let us know in the comment section down below. We will see them and of course reply to them.
Of course.
Okay, guys, I'll see you in our upcoming video.
Hasta luego.
Nuestro amor es imposible. Nunca podrá ser. No me digas eso. Federico Armando Martínez Arteaga.
Okay, my friends from SpanishBall101.com, as you know, my real name is Diego.
And I'm Efraín.
And today in this video, we're going to check some Mexican telenovela phrases that you should know. So, enjoy the video. Woo!
You may love them, or you may hate them, or you may love them and hate them at once, but at least, everyone, not in the world, but everyone that we know, have seen at least one episode of a Mexican telenovela. For example, María la del Barrio, when it was first released, it was known in at least 120 countries around the world.
Yeah, that's right. So, in this video, we're going to cover some expressions that are at the same time cheesy but also kind of entertaining, so yeah. You will feel like the sensation that you're watching a telenovela. So let's start with the first one.
Acepto casarme contigo aunque no te amo. I will marry you even though I don't love you. And of course you will say this to someone who you need to marry, but you don't necessarily love him or love her.
Me las vas a pagar, Ernesto García de Fernando Lorca. You are going to pay this, Armando Ernesto García Lorca.
You changed the name there.
It doesn't matter, he's going to pay anyway.
Anyways.
No!
No, por favor, no me haga daño. No, please, don't hurt me. And of course you say this to someone who wants to hurt you. And you don't want to be hurt, of course.
Lo nuestro no puede ser. This can happen.
That's annoying.
Lo nuestro no puede ser. Our love could never be. And you say this when you don't like a person and you don't want to hurt his or her
feelings.
Her feelings.
Yeah. Me voy a vengar, Pablo, por lo que le hiciste a mi hermana. I'm going to take revenge, Pablo, for what you did to my sister. And of course you will say this when you want to take revenge on someone, so it's very, pretty easy.
Tú y yo somos primos. Esto es pecado. This is... you and I are cousins. This is a sin. And of course you say this when you
have a forbidden love between cousins.
It happens.
No, no, no. Just kidding.
Borra eso.
Te vas a quemar en las llamas del infierno, José Manuel. You are going to burn in the flames of the hell. So sometimes in Mexican telenovelas, the more adjectives you use, the merrier. So it's not just born in hell, but born in the flames of hell.
Whoa. Si no eres mío, no serás de nadie.
If you are not mine, you won't be anybody's. And you say this when you break up with someone, or someone breaks up with you, and
you want to kill him or kill him. No, of course not. No, you want to show that you can't be with someone else, or you don't want him or don't want her to be with someone else.
Of course, this is a telenovela's line.
We
would never use it.
We will never use it. Well, no. Not often. No.
Not that often.
Not that often.
Pero Carla Cecilia, te amo. No importa que esta es la segunda vez que te veo.
Carla Cecilia, I love you. It doesn't matter that this is just the second time that I see you. So this is obviously a bit exaggerated because you cannot love someone in just 2 days, right? So, but anyways, in the telenovelas, it can happen because that's true love.
Mm-hmm.
Nuestro amor es imposible. Our love is impossible. And you say this when the parents of your girl doesn't want you to marry her.
That happens. Or date her only, not just marry her.
Diego, algún día encontraré el amor. Nunca me rendiré.
Jamás te rindas. El amor puede estar a la vuelta de la esquina.
Oh, sí. Okay, that's it for today, friends of SpanishPod101.com. If you like this video, please share it with other learners and give us your thumbs up. Write your comments down below. We will reply to them as soon as possible. And see you in the next video.
Hasta luego. Hi there, my friends from SpanishPod101.com. As you might know, my name is Diego. What's happening, Efraín?
Traigo adolorido el brazo, me duele la cabeza y tengo un dolor de muelas bien fuerte.
Oh my god. Well, I hope you recover soon. So, well, I hope guys that you enjoyed this video.
So, Diego, let me tell you guys and Diego a story.
Yeah.
Once I went to Canada.
Yes.
Okay? So, I was walking in the woods. And I got bitten in my glute by a raccoon.
What?
Yeah, man, that's true. And I went to the medical center, and I barely know English in those times, so I couldn't explain myself properly.
Okay.
So I did mimic. I was like, no, then. And they were like, what animal was that? Well, it was funny.
Okay, very good. Okay, so yeah, that's a very common story. Well, not the raccoon part, but it is common that we don't know how to express ourselves, especially when we have pain. So that's why in this video we're going to cover that. And basically, the most common verb to express this pain is doler. And doler is an irregular verb because it changes the O when conjugated. It changes the O for U-E. So, but not only that, but also it works very similar as the verb me gusta. Do you remember that verb me gusta? Me gusta, te gusta, le gusta. So this verb works the same. So, whereas in English, you will say, for example, my head hurts, okay? In Spanish, you wouldn't say my head hurts, no, but rather, the head hurts me. Basically, you will say that in Spanish, okay? So, that being said, as the verb gustar, you will say, me duele la cabeza. Me duele la cabeza, okay? Very good. Now, once again, since we can have a singular or plural nouns, you will change the verb depending on whether it is singular or it is plural. Cabeza is singular because, well, I just have one head, obviously. But, however, I have two eyes, okay?
So, if I'm in front of my screen or my computer for about 8 hours, it is normal that my eyes hurt, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, I will say, me duelen los ojos. Me duelen los ojos. So, what are the most common pains? Let's see. So, you can say, once again, me duele la cabeza. But you can also say, me duele el estómago. Mm. Or, me duele, maybe, el brazo. Or, me duele la espalda. Me duele el hombro. Me duele la garganta. I can barely speak now. Or, me duele el cuello. Mm. Or even, maybe, because I have been standing all day, me duelen las rodillas. My knees hurt.
So, as Diego said, the verb for expressing pain is doler. Okay, so doler also has a noun, and this is dolor. So you can also express pain using this noun. The structure will be pronoun, yo, the verb tener, the noun doler, plus the preposition de, and the complement, okay? So, yo tengo, tú tienes, nosotros tenemos, ellos, ellas, ustedes tienen, etc. Yo tengo dolor de cabeza, okay? But remember this, there is no difference between plural and singular. No difference at all. Let's continue. Tengo dolor de muelas.
My molars, yeah.
Tengo dolor de rodillas.
De rodillas.
Tengo dolor de rodillas. Tengo dolor de estómago. Okay, this is singular. And rodillas were plural. So there is no difference. Tengo dolor de cabeza.
Very good. Nice. So far we have the verb doler.
Uh-huh.
Then we have the noun dolor.
Uh-huh.
But we now also have the adjective adolorido, and that's another way for expressing the pain. Okay? So, and you normally express it with the verb estar. So this is also common, but it has special uses. So you will say it, for example, when you want to express in general that you are in pain. That's basically the translation. So adolorido, it means in pain.
Okay.
Or when your muscles or a part of your body is sore. So in that case, you will use adolorido. Mm-hmm. So for example, you can use it in general. Efraín, estoy adolorido. Todo el cuerpo me duele. Tengo el cuerpo cortado. Oh. Oh, I hate you. But for example, if you go to the gym and you are working out, after a while you can say, hey, tengo el brazo adolorido. Okay, because your muscles are sore. Tengo el brazo adolorido. It would be much better instead of just saying, me duele el brazo. Okay, because maybe you were, I don't know, you got medicine, like you got an injection, mm-hmm. or something. But you will say instead, tengo el brazo adolorido. Okay, guys. Now, we have also another adjective for pain. But this is not really like for expressing pain, but to express that something is painful. Okay? So, and that adjective is doloroso. And this could be either an emotional pain, maybe, or a physical pain.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So, that's doloroso. Doloroso.
Doloroso.
For example,
ayer vi a mi ex con su nuevo novio. Es doloroso.
Ah, yo también la vi, pero está remenso ese cuate, ¿no?
Sí, tienes toda la razón. Es muy, muy tonto. Or even I can say, Efraín, no camines por vidrios. No, es muy doloroso. So, well, now, finally, we're going to see what kind of pain is the one that we are presenting, right? The degree of pain in terms of degree. How painful something is.
Okay. ¿Qué clase de dolor es? El dolor va y viene.
es intermitente. The pain comes and goes, ¿ok? El dolor arde, quema. Uy. The pain burns, ¿ok? El dolor es constante. The pain is constant, ¿ok? So, next one. El dolor es agudo. The pain is very strong. Next one. El dolor es sordo. How would you translate it?
You will say it's dull pain. When it is audible, but it's constant. It's dull pain.
So, the next one. El dolor es punzante.
That will be like sharp pain. Punzante. Sharp pain.
El dolor es compresión. O es pesado. El dolor es pesado.
Exactly. Like with pressure. Like when you think like something is pressuring. Like compresión.
Another one. El dolor corre. For example, el dolor corre por toda mi pierna.
Corre, se extiende por toda mi pierna o corre por toda mi pierna. Like runs throughout my leg, through all my leg.
So now, let's go to some examples so you can practice what we learned in this beautiful lesson.
Yeah, sure, why not? So, for example, how would I express Efraín that my stomach hurts? Me duele el estómago or tengo dolor de estómago. Very good. Now, imagine this situation. You go to the gym, you work out, and you work out especially your shoulders. So, how would you express that here your shoulder is in pain? Estoy adolorido del hombro. Yeah, my shoulder is in pain. Okay, now, the next one. How would I ask Efraín if something hurts him? Efraín, ¿te duele algo o estás adolorido?
Now, how would you reply to this question? Me duele la garganta. O tengo dolor de garganta.
Very nice. Did you got them correct?
Woo! That's it for today, friends of SpanishPod101.com. I hope that you liked this video. If so, please share it with other people that might like to express pain in Spanish, okay? So, write your comments down below. We will reply to them, and if you like this video, like this channel and follow these two guys. See you in our next video. Hasta luego.
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hola, soy Brenda Romaniello, tu profesora de español. Today we're going to learn ordinal numbers in Spanish. Los números ordinales en español. The main difference between cardinal numbers and ordinal numbers is that cardinal numbers basically specify the amount of something that we have, and the ordinal numbers, what they do is basically specify or tell us about the order of things. For example, un hombre o una mujer, a man and a woman, dos hombres, dos mujeres, two men or two women, 31 días, 31 days. When the number uno is used in plural, it means some or a couple or a few as well. Por ejemplo, unos hombres o unas mujeres, we can say it means some men or some women. In the case of ordinal numbers, we use it to express order. right? Or just to talk about the order of things. Por ejemplo, la primera vez significa the first time, o el quinto coche significa the fifth car. Just like cardinal numbers, ordinal numbers are adjectives, and we are going to place them before the noun that they are modifying. Yes, so we're going to say la primera vez, no vez primera. Muy bien, muy importante. And the other thing that we need to consider about ordinal numbers is they are going to change in gender. Yes, we're going to have masculino and femenino, and also in terms of number, depending on what they're modifying. So in the case of la primera vez, vez es femenino. So vez here is feminine, so that's why we, and singular, that's why we have to say la primera vez. Okay, so that's primera is singular y femenino, right? So that's why we are matching here the ordinal number, this adjective, with the noun that is modifying. In the case of a masculine ordinal number, when we have to match to a male singular noun, for example, we can say, este es mi segundo coche. See, this is my second car. In this case, coche es singular y masculino. We have to match segundo to this noun. Let's have a look at some examples. Es el segundo carro que he comprado. Es el segundo carro que he comprado. Los primeros días de nuestras vacaciones fueron fantásticos. Los primeros días de nuestras vacaciones fueron fantásticos. Mira la octava página. Mira la octava página. Fuimos las primeras personas invitadas a la fiesta. Fuimos las primeras personas invitadas a la fiesta. Something really quickly that I want to show with you. I was sharing different examples, one with coche, one with carro. They are exactly the same. They both mean car. It's just that carro is mostly used in Latin America, in for example, Mexico, and coche is mostly used in Spain. Vamos a aprender entonces los números ordinales de el primero al décimo. So now we're going to learn the ordinal numbers from the first to the tenth. And these are very important for you to try to learn, internalize and memorize, because anything that goes after after the 11th or the 20th, etc., we'll use these 10 first numbers. So once you master these first 10 numbers, ordinal numbers, then you're going to be able to form the following ones. Muy bien, repite después de mí. Repeat after me. Primero. Primero. Segundo. Segundo. Tercero. Tercero. Cuarto. Cuarto. Quinto. Quinto. Sexto. Sexto. Séptimo. Séptimo. Octavo. Octavo. Noveno. Noveno. Décimo, décimo. Muy bien. When they come before nouns, they are singular and masculine. Primero and tercero are shortened to primer and tercer. This is very important and something I want you to pay attention. Pay attention. For example, por ejemplo, el primer presidente. El tercer capítulo. Basically, when we have primero and tercero before a noun that is masculino and singular, we're going to remove that end O, that final O, and we're going to leave it as primer and tercer. Muy bien, so mi primer primo. Muy bien, my first cousin. Mi primer coche, my first car. O mi tercer hijo, my third son. So as you can see here, if, remember, If the noun that we're modifying is masculino and singular, we're going to change primero and tercero to primer and tercer. Vamos a ver los números ordinales del décimo primero al décimo noveno. Now let's have a look at the ordinal numbers from the 11th till the 19th. So in order to form these numbers, these ordinal numbers in Spanish, we are going to need the numbers that we have already learned from the first, el primero, to the ninth, el noveno. Let's have a look at the formula that we can use for these numbers. We're going to use the number décimo, and then we're going to add whichever number from the first to the ninth, del primero al noveno, that we need to form the number. Let's have a look at some examples. 13th, we can say décimo tercero. Décimo tercero. 15th, decimos décimo más quinto. Then we're going to say décimo quinto. Or if you want to say the 17th, we're going to say décimo más or plus séptimo. And in that case, the number is décimo séptimo. Just know that the accent in décimo is removed in these ordinal numbers. Let's start now with the 11th, yes? So we have two forms to say this. The 11th, we're going to say décimo primero o un décimo. Then we're going to say décimo segundo o duodécimo. Then it's pretty much straightforward. Repeat after me. Décimo tercero. Décimo tercero. Décimo cuarto. Décimo cuarto. Décimo quinto. Décimo quinto. Décimo sexto. Décimo sexto. Décimo séptimo. Décimo séptimo. Décimo octavo. Décimo octavo. Décimo noveno. Décimo noveno. Two things I want to mention here. The first one is, let's have a look at décimo octavo. As you can see here, we were saying that we form these ordinal numbers by saying décimo plus the other ordinal number. But in this case, because it's going to sound strange to have two O's, we basically remove one O, yes? We're going to say décimo octavo, yes? So there's no two O's in here. The other thing that I want to point out is that, as you can see, these numbers seem such long words, and this may scare some people to be able to pronounce this, yes? Because they seem so long, these words in Spanish. My tip, my pro tip for you is going to be just read and mention every single letter in these long words, and you'll be able to speak perfect Spanish and pronounce it perfectly fine. Vamos a ver algunas variaciones en la forma en que se escriben estos números. Let's have a look at some variations in the spelling of these numbers. According to La RAE, which is the Royal Academy of Spanish, it is also acceptable to write the ordinal numbers from décimo primero to décimo noveno in two separate words. So you can say, for example, for 13th, we can say décimo tercero as two separate words. 15th, décimo quinto, and 17th, décimo séptimo. Now, we need to pay attention that when written in two separate words, both words must agree in the gender and the number of the noun that they are modifying. For example, let's have a look at some examples here. La décimo primera página, see, la décimo primera página, as you can see here, we say décimo. Very good. And the second one, the second option, which is also correct, we can say la décima primera página. But here, the two words are separated. And also pay attention that we are going to keep the written accent in the second form as well. Okay, congratulations! Felicidades! we have learned the ordinal numbers from 1st to 19th. And now we're going to go over intense. Yes, because pretty much it's very repetitive. We are basically using the same formula. So now I want you to give you the tenths so that you can start to form more ordinal numbers. So let's start with 20th, 30th, 40th, 50th, etc., etc. Repite después de mí. So repeat after me. Vigésimo. Vigésimo. Trigésimo. Trigésimo. Cuadragésimo. Cuadragésimo. Quincuagésimo. Quincuagésimo. Sexagésimo. Sexagésimo. Septuagésimo. Septuagésimo. Octogésimo. Octogésimo. Nonagésimo. Nonagésimo. Don't you feel smarter by being able to say these words? I certainly feel like I am. So something to pay attention, like I was mentioning before, in order to form all the rest of the numbers, we're just going to mention whatever the base number divided by 10 is, plus the ordinal number between primero and noveno. See, let's have a look at some examples. 21st, we're going to say vigésimo plus primero, then we're going to say vigésimo primero. Pretty simple. 36th, we're going to say trigésimo plus sexto, then it becomes trigésimo sexto. And 99th is going to be nonagésimo plus noveno is going to be nonagésimo noveno. Now let's talk about placement. Where do we place these ordinal numbers? Just like the cardinal numbers, we are going to most of the time use it before the noun that we're modifying. Mi primer carro, mi segunda casa. But if we're talking about a member of royalty, then we're going to place it after the noun that we're modifying. Por ejemplo, Carlos V. If the cardinal number and the ordinal number are appearing together, the cardinal number is going to go before the ordinal number. Por ejemplo, me encantan las dos primeras escenas. Me encantan las dos primeras escenas. Estuve enferma los tres primeros días. Estuve enferma los tres primeros días. And for the last part of this lesson, let's have a look at the ordinal numbers above 100. So we're going to go over the hundredths. Repeat after me. Repite después de mí. Centésimo. Centésimo. Ducentésimo. Ducentésimo. Tricentésimo. Tricentésimo. Cuadringentésimo. Cuadringentésimo. Quingentésimo. Quingentésimo. Sexentésimo. Sexentésimo. Septingentésimo. Septingentésimo. Octingentésimo. Octingentésimo. Noningentésimo. Noningentésimo. Y el último, the last one, milésimo. Milésimo. That is all for today. Thank you so much for watching. Nos vemos en la próxima clase. I'll see you next class. Adiós. Hola, soy Brenda Romagnello, tu profesora de español. Bienvenidos a tu clase. Welcome to your Spanish class. I'm Brenda Romagnello. Hoy vamos a aprender vocabulario y expresiones de negocios en español. Today we're going to learn some must-know business expressions in Spanish. The first thing that I would like to say is that because we're talking about business, negocios, we're most likely going to be using in Spanish the formal register, which requires the use of you in the formal form, which is usted. First, we're going to see different scenarios where it is appropriate to use these expressions. We'll learn some vocabulary and we'll learn some useful expressions, business expressions that you must know. Let's start with some jobs. Profesiones.
Some occupations have commonly used the feminine forms, such as ingeniero or ingeniera, which are the feminine and the masculine form of these professions, or psicólogo and psicóloga for psychologist, but some others actually stay the same. For example, electricista, dentista, and periodista, which are electrician, dentist, and journalist, they always remain the same, regardless if they are a woman or a man.
Repite después de mí. Repeat after me.
Doctor, doctora. Dentista. Enfermero, enfermera. Maestro, maestra. Profesor, profesora. So the difference here is that usually maestro is for a teacher from kindergarten or primary school, and then from high school and university, usually we call them profesor. Contador, contadora. Abogado, abogada. Diseñador, diseñadora. Consultor financiero, consultora financiera. Secretario, secretaria. Asistente de ventas. Electricista. Plomero. Cocinero, cocinera, chef. Empresario, empresaria. Vamos a estudiar ahora un poco de vocabulario. Let's study this vocabulary. La oficina central. La oficina central. La sucursal. El departamento. El departamento. Empleado de oficina. Empleado de oficina. Gerente. Gerente. Let's have a look at some sentences that we can use with this vocabulary. La oficina central está en Madrid. La oficina central está en Madrid. Soy plomero. Soy plomero. Ella es estudiante. Es estudiante.
Muy bien, vamos a practicar. Let's practice. How would you say this? The head office is in Madrid. I work in the marketing department. I am a businesswoman. I am a businessman.
The answers are, número uno, number one, la oficina central está en Madrid. Número dos, number two, trabajo en el departamento de marketing. Número tres, soy empresaria o soy una mujer de negocios. Número cuatro, soy empresario o soy un hombre de negocios.
Just on a side note, I would say that empresario or empresaria is used to refer to entrepreneurs or people who own their own businesses. Hombre de negocios o mujer de negocios is more a term to describe women or men who run businesses. So that's what they do, but not to introduce themselves when they're talking to somebody. Muy bien, ahora vamos a ver vocabulario y expresiones para la oficina. Let's have a look at some vocabulary and expressions for in the office. Yes, when you are in an office. Let's start with some vocabulary for the office.
Vocabulario de la oficina. Let's have a look at some vocabulary for the office. We're going to start with computadora or ordenador. Some other countries in Latin America also call it computador. So for a laptop, we're going to say computadora portátil. Or ordenador portátil, computador portátil. Pantalla. Pantalla is the screen. Silla. Silla significa chair. Keyboard. Se dice teclado. Teclado. Be aware that the Spanish computer keyboard has a different layout to the standard one that you might be used to. Remember, we have different written accents to add to certain vowels, as well as the ñ, yes. So all these letters, of course, need to be in the Spanish keyboard. Diary, se dice agenda, agenda. Pen, we say in Spanish bolígrafo, or also pluma, bolígrafo, pluma. Ratón, o mouse, ratón, mouse. Cajón, cajón significa drawer. Teléfono, teléfono. Be careful here, I want you to put the emphasis of this word in the second E, teléfono. No, I don't want you to hear, I don't want to hear you saying teléfono, okay? Es teléfono. And the last one, printer, we say impresora, impresora. Vamos a estudiar otro vocabulario. Let's study some other vocabulary that is very important for you to know. Repeat after me. Correo electrónico, email. They're both pretty much used the same. Internet. Contraseña. Mensaje de voz. Máquina de fax. Fotocopiadora. Tarjeta de negocios. Reunión, conferencia, cuaderno o libreta de notas, engrapadora, reloj.
Muy bien, ahora vamos a ver algunas expresiones que son comunes en una oficina. So now let's have a look at some expressions that are common in an office.
Repite después de mí para estudiar estas frases útiles. Repeat after me so that we practice these useful phrases. Necesito hacer algunas copias. Necesito hacer algunas copias. Me gustaría organizar una cita. Me gustaría organizar una cita. Quiero enviar un email. Quiero enviar un correo electrónico. Disculpe, tengo que tomar esta llamada. Disculpe, tengo que tomar esta llamada.
Perfecto. Ahora vamos a practicar. Now let's practice. How would you say it in Spanish? I would like to arrange a meeting. I need to send a fax. Do you have a laptop?
Muy bien. Entonces, so, how are you going to say this? I'd like to arrange a meeting. I would like to arrange a meeting. Me gustaría organizar una reunión. I need to send a fax. ¿Cómo se dice? Necesito enviar un fax. Necesito enviar un fax. ¿Cómo se dice? Do you have a laptop? ¿Tiene una computadora portátil? ¿Tiene una computadora portátil? Muy bien, excelente.
The next context is el mundo académico. Let's now have a look at some vocabulary and expressions that we can use in the academic world. Vamos a empezar con un poco de vocabulario. Let's start with some vocabulary.
Ahora vamos a estudiar un poco de vocabulario del mundo académico. So let's study some vocabulary from the academic world. Repite después de mí. La conferencia. El seminario, la sala de conferencias, la exposición, el profesor universitario, La profesora universitaria. Medicina. Ciencias. Literatura. Informática. Arte.
Here are some useful expressions.
Vamos a estudiar estas frases útiles. Let's study these useful phrases. ¿Cuál es su área? ¿Cuál es su área? Estoy haciendo investigación científica. Estoy haciendo investigación científica. Tengo un diploma en derecho. Tengo un diploma en derecho. Voy a dar una conferencia sobre arquitectura moderna. Voy a dar una conferencia sobre arquitectura moderna.
Now we're going to practice. Let's have a look at some exercises. How would you say this in Spanish? I'm doing research in medicine. I have a degree in literature. She is a professor.
¿Cómo se dice? I'm doing research in medicine. Se dice, estoy haciendo investigación en medicina. ¿Cómo se dice, I have a degree in literature? Tengo un diploma en literatura. How about, she's the professor? Es la profesora. O ella es la profesora. Muy buen trabajo.
Ahora vamos a ver un poco de vocabulario y expresiones de los negocios. Now let's have a look at some vocabulary and expressions for business. Let's start with some vocabulario, some vocabulary.
Vamos ahora a estudiar vocabulario del mundo de los negocios. So now let's study vocabulary from the world of business. Repeat after me. Repite después de mí. La orden, or if we're talking about the verb, we will say ordenar. La orden, ordenar. La entrega, or if we are talking about the verb, we'll say entregar. El pago. El presupuesto. El precio. Los documentos. La factura. La estimación. Las ganancias. Las ventas. ¿Firmamos el contrato? Shall we sign the contract? ¿Firmamos el contrato? El ejecutivo. El o la cliente. El contrato.
Now, let's move on to some useful expressions.
Vamos a estudiar estas frases útiles. Let's study these useful phrases. ¿Me puede enviar el contrato, por favor? ¿Me puede enviar el contrato, por favor? ¿Hemos acordado un precio? ¿Hemos acordado un precio? ¿Cuándo puede hacer la entrega? ¿Cuándo puede hacer la entrega? ¿Cuál es el presupuesto? ¿Cuál es el presupuesto? ¿Me puede enviar la factura? ¿Me puede enviar la factura?
Muy bien, vamos a practicar. Let's practice. Can you say this in Spanish? Can you send me the estimate? Can you send me the estimate? Have we agreed a budget? When can you send me the contract?
Entonces, ¿cómo se dice? How do you say it? Can you send me the estimate? ¿Me puede enviar la estimación? ¿Cómo se dice? Have we agreed a budget? ¿Hemos acordado un presupuesto? How do you say, when can you send me the contract? ¿Cuándo me puede enviar el contrato? ¡Excelente trabajo!
Muy bien, eso es todo por hoy. Muchas gracias por ver la clase y nos vemos en la próxima. I will see you next class. Adiós, hasta luego. Today, we're going to have a look at the use of past participles as adjectives in Spanish. Hoy vamos a ver el uso del participio como adjetivo en español. Vamos a analizar estas cuatro oraciones. La empresa ha contratado a Ana. La empresa ha contratado a Pedro. El empleado contratado tiene un diploma en economía. La mujer contratada tiene 10 años de experiencia. Mira las diferentes formas y los usos de contratado y contratada. Let's analyze these phrases and have a look, pay attention to the past participle hired, contratado and contratada, and see how they are used in these four sentences. El participio de los verbos es una forma no personal del verbo, igual que el infinitivo o el gerundio. ¿Sí? Por ejemplo, hablar, hablando y hablado. El participio es hablado, el infinitivo es hablar y el gerundio es hablando. Estas son formas no personales del verbo. En el caso de los participios, podemos usar los participios para como un verbo, ¿sí? Cuando lo usamos con el pretérito perfecto compuesto o antepresente. También lo podemos usar solo para modificar sustantivos, ¿sí? Lo podemos usar como un adjetivo calificativo para describir a cosas o personas. Cuando lo usamos como un adjetivo, tenemos que tener en cuenta que va a cambiar de género, ¿sí? Masculino y femenino, y también de número. Tenemos que cambiarlo a plural o singular, dependiendo de lo que estamos modificando. So the past participle is a no personal form of the verbs, the same as the infinitives and the gerund. So the infinitive, for example, in Spanish is hablar, yes, to talk. The gerund will be everything that is ando o yendo when we have the ing form in English, right? For example, hablando, speaking. And the past participle of the verb is, for example, hablado, which is spoken in English. We use the past participle when we want to form the present perfect tense, for example. And also, we are going to use past participle as adjectives in Spanish. When we use them as adjectives, we have to be careful that we have to see what we are modifying, because we are going to use them as descriptions, yes, for to describe things and people, and therefore we need to pay attention what we're describing, because we have to match the noun, yes, what we're describing in gender, masculino and femenino, and also in number, singular and plural. ¿Cómo formamos los participios de los verbos? Vamos a tomar el verbo, ¿sí? Y la terminación del verbo infinitivo, vamos a sacar la terminación y vamos a reemplazarla por ado en el caso de los verbos que terminan con ar. Por ejemplo, hablar, hablado, trabajar, trabajado, cantar, cantado, etc. Y los verbos que terminan en er o ir, vamos a sacar la terminación y la vamos a reemplazar por ido. Por ejemplo, comer, comido, leer, leído, vivir, vivido, recibir, recibido. Así se forman los participios regulares del español. Cuando lo usamos con el pretérito perfecto o pretérito perfecto compuesto o antepresente, por ejemplo, lo vamos a usar con el auxiliar haber, ¿sí? Por ejemplo, he comido la pizza, ¿sí? I have eaten the pizza, he comido la pizza. Aquí estamos usándolo como un verbo, ¿sí? Una perífrasis verbal con el verbo el auxiliar haber. En este caso, no es un adjetivo. No lo estamos usando como un adjetivo. En este caso es parte del verbo. Siempre que va con haber, será parte del verbo. Cuando lo usamos como adjetivo, por lo general va a estar modificando a un sustantivo directamente, ¿sí? Por ejemplo, la mujer sentada, ¿sí? The seated woman. O puede estar también usado con después del verbo estar, ¿sí? La mujer está sentada, el hombre está sentado, los niños están sentados. O los niños sentados son mis sobrinos. ¿Puedes ver aquí la diferencia? How are we going to form the past participle of the verbs? We're going to have a look at the three different endings of the verbs in Spanish in the infinitive form. So the verbs ending in "-ar", like hablar, trabajar, bailar, cantar, etc. So we're going to remove the "-ar", the ending, and we're going to replace it for "-ado". So hablar is going to become hablado, trabajar, trabajado, cantar, cantado. And the verbs ending in "-er" or "-ir", we're going to change the ending "-er" and "-ir" for "-ido", and form the past participle that way. Por ejemplo, comer comido, leer leído, ¿sí? Eaten or read, y vivir vivido, recibir recibido. So to live, lived, and to receive, received. When we use it in the present tense, in the Spanish present tense, we are going to always have that auxiliary verb haber that is going to accompany this or precede these past participles. And that's how we know that they are not an adjective in that respect, they are part of the verb. For example, he comido pizza, I have eaten pizza. It will always be following haber when it's used in the verb, as a verb. When we use it as an adjective, it will be following a noun, yes, a person or a thing, and it's going to be describing this person or this thing. See, for example, la señora sentada, yes, or the seated woman, or el señor sentado, yes, and you can see here that it's going to change the gender, right, because we're describing the woman or the man, and also in the plural, los niños sentados. And when we use it as an adjective, it's also very common that we'll have it with the verb to be estar. Yes, so la mujer está sentada, the woman is seated. El hombre está sentado, the man is seated. Los niños están sentados, the children are seated. En el caso de los cuatro ejemplos que estábamos analizando al principio de la clase, puedes ver que las primeras dos oraciones estamos usando el participio como un verbo, como forma verbal del presente del pretérito perfecto o el pretérito perfecto compuesto. La empresa ha contratado. Ha contratado, aquí tenemos el verbo haber más el participio. Es un verbo. Es incorrecto, ¿sí? O es incorrecto si estamos diciendo que la empresa ha contratado a Ana. Es incorrecto decir, bueno, Ana es mujer, entonces tengo que poner el verbo en femenino. La empresa ha contratado a Ana. No, es incorrecto. Tenemos que decir la empresa ha contratado, ¿sí? Porque no importa si la empresa es femenino o si Ana es femenino, el verbo siempre es igual. ¿Cuándo cambia el género del participio? Cuando lo estamos usando como un adjetivo para describir a una cosa o a unas personas. En el ejemplo 3 y 4, ¿sí? El empleado contratado. Contratado es el empleado. Estamos describiendo al empleado. The hired employee. Yes? No, I have hired, or the company has hired, is the hired person, el empleado, the employee. Y en este caso, empleado es masculino, por eso vamos a decir contratado. Cuando decimos la mujer contratada, tenemos que cambiar a la forma femenina, porque ahora estamos describiendo una mujer, the hired woman, estamos diciendo en este caso. So in the case of the four examples that we were looking and analyzing at the beginning of the lesson, we can see that the first two we are referring, it's a phrasal verb. So the past participle here in Spanish is used as a part of the verb. And you can see it or recognize it because is straight after el verbo auxiliar haber. Yes, yeah, so la empresa ha contratado a Ana o la empresa ha contratado a Pedro. It doesn't matter that la empresa is feminine or the company is feminine or Ana is feminine, is a woman, Pedro is a man. It doesn't matter. Here we're just using the verb, which is always the same. We conjugated the same. Yes, for the third person singular. Yes, ha contratado. Yes, it doesn't matter because it's not being used as an adjective in these cases. When we say la mujer contratada o el empleado contratado, here we are not using the verb haber, so we're not using it as a verb. Here we're using it as an adjective to describe el empleado, the employee, and the woman, la mujer. So here we are saying the hired man and the hired woman. So as you can see here, the people that we're describing have different genders, so that's why we have to change and match these genders to the people that we're describing here. Hay algunos participios irregulares. Vamos a ver algunos de los más comunes. Y vamos a verlos con algunos ejemplos de cómo los usamos como adjetivos. Por ejemplo, abrir, abierto. La puerta está abierta. El coche está abierto. Cubrir, cubierto. Por ejemplo, el cielo está cubierto. La piscina está cubierta. Decir, dicho. Por ejemplo, dicho contrato es importante. La dicha firma está más arriba. Hacer, hecho. El pastel está hecho. La cama no está hecha. Imprimir, impreso. El libro está impreso. La carta está impresa. Morir, muerto. Cervantes está muerto. La reina Sofía está muerta. Poner, puesto. El botón está puesto. La camisa está puesta. Resolver, resuelto. El problema está resuelto. La crisis está resuelta. Romper, roto. El coche está roto. La televisión está rota. Ver, visto. El tema ya está visto. La clase está vista. Muy bien, ahora vamos a practicar el uso del participio como un adjetivo. Vamos a describir estas cosas. Puedes usar el verbo y entre paréntesis y ponerlo en el participio como un adjetivo. Cuidado, tienes que cambiar el género y número dependiendo de lo que estemos modificando. Now let's practice. I'm going to show you a few things. We're going to describe a few things. And I want you to form the past participle of this verse between brackets. And we're going to use them as adjectives. So be careful, pay attention when you have to change gender and number accordingly. Número uno. Este camarón está. Número dos. Esta manzana está. Número 3. Este pan está. Número 4. El lápiz está. Número 5. Este melón está. Número 6. Este queso está. Este apio está. Respuestas. Número 1. Este camarón está cocido. Número 2. Esta manzana está mordida. Número 3. Este pan está quemado. Número 4. El lápiz está roto. Número 5. Este melón está partido. Número 6. Este queso está rebanado. Y número 7, este apio está picado. Muy bien, eso es todo por hoy. Muchísimas gracias por ver la clase y nos vemos en la próxima. Thank you so much for watching. I really hope that now you understand how to use past participles in Spanish as adjectives. I will see you next class. Adiós, nos vemos. Hasta luego. Hola, soy Brenda Romagnello, tu profesora de español. Today we're going to learn what Latin time is and how schedules work in Latin America and in Spain. I'm going to teach you all about the Latin time in Spanish. Let's begin with what is Latin time? Latin time, have you ever heard of that? The Latin time is a specific time zone that only exists in Latin America, and I think it also happens in Spain, where it seems like Latinos have their own specific time for things, events, etc. It is sort of well known, and probably this is going to be a stereotype, yes, about Latin people, that we are always late. Yeah, so I always use this as an excuse when I am running late to a specific party or an event, you know, I am running on Latin time. Yes, and I am well known for people to maybe, and no, maybe not now, I actually got a lot better, thank you very much, muchas gracias. But back in the day, I think in the past, people used to tell me half an hour before things, you know, before the actual event. They will tell me things, parties, events were actually taking place half an hour earlier than it was supposed to, because they knew I was going to be running at least half an hour late. So that is what we call Latin time, where things take a little bit longer or nothing really happens on time. It's usually time is an indication of when, about that time when things are going to happen. So expect on your holidays, if you go to Latin America and Spain, that things will not go on the dot. Of course, be there just in case they do, but usually speaking, allow some extra time for things to happen because it's more of an estimation and not necessarily a specific period when things are going to happen. I remember the first experience when I moved to Sydney in Australia around 11 years ago now. I remember the first time that I was catching a bus, and I checked the schedule for the bus, and it said that the bus was going to stop at the bus stop at, say, 9:17 a.m. And I'm like, wow, that's so specific, like 9:17, what is that about? I mean, just say 9:15, I mean, I'll be there 9:15 and then the bus will pass, you know, between then and 20 past or 25 past. And I was so shocked when the bus actually stopped at 9:17 a.m. on the dot, at the bus stop. And I was like, wow, that is crazy, I thought, because I come from this culture where, you know, usually time is an estimation. Not necessarily maybe if it is for airplanes or for trains, but things are expected to have a bit of a different timing. So I know it's considered rude in the English culture to not show up on time or to be late and things like that, but do not take this as an offense. It is something that is just cultural. How schedules work? Usually speaking, if we're talking about trains or airplanes, we do think that things will probably be on time, but if it is buses or people in formal situations like parties or people going to see you or visit you at your home, it's very likely that people will be running on Latin time, which could be 5 minutes delay to, I would say, up to half an hour delay. if you are having an interview, for example, for a job interview in the Latin world or in Spain, I would recommend that you actually do show up in time. Do not run on Latin time yourself, especially for formal or important serious situations. Muy bien, muchas gracias y nos vemos en la próxima clase. That's all for today. I will see you next class. Adiós, hasta luego. Hola, soy Brenda Romagnello. Bienvenidos a otra clase de español. Welcome to another Spanish class. Today we're going to have a look at the Spanish subjects. What are they and how do they work? Let's start with what is a subject, a Spanish subject. So the subject in a sentence, when we talk in, say, grammatical terms, in grammar, a subject is the person or the thing that is going to perform the action in a sentence. Yes, for example, if I say yo hablo español, I speak Spanish, I is the subject here because I am performing the action of speaking Spanish. If I say el perro corre en el parque, the dog runs in the park, the subject here is el perro. Can you see? El perro, the dog, is performing the action of running in the park. So when we talk about subjects in Spanish, we are referring to the people or animals or things that perform actions when we talk about them in a sentence. So it's easy when it is a specific person, say for example Ana, or if we want to talk about the subject being Pedro and Julián, that perform an action, that they are the subject. But also when we talk about the personal pronouns, the people who are performing actions in Spanish, they are subjects as well. So what we are going to learn in how the subjects in Spanish work, we are going to learn the personal pronouns in Spanish. Repite después de mí. Repeat after me. Yo, tú, vos, usted, él, ella, él o ella for it, plural, nosotros, nosotras, ustedes, vosotros, vosotras, ellos, ellas. Okay, so if we have a look at this table here, what we can see is that there are six different ways to translate you in Spanish. We're going to say tú, vos, usted, ustedes, vosotros, and vosotras. If we pay attention here, tú, vos, and usted are singular pronouns, which means that they are used to address one person only, while ustedes, vosotros, and vosotras are the plural form of you and is used to talk to two or more people at the same time. Something really important to mention is that when we are referring to a group of people, when you have mixed genders, in the general form is going to be the masculino. Yeah? So for example, if we are in a group and we have some mix of men and women, then we are going to call ourselves nosotros, even if there are women in the group. The general word for the pronouns for people when we describe things like this is going to be the masculino. Yes, we have to be all women to be able to call ourselves nosotras. What is the difference between tú and vos? So tú is an informal register of you, the same as vos, but the difference is that tú is used in Latin America and Spain, and vos is only used in Argentina, Uruguay, and certain parts of Colombia. We don't use tú, for example, in Argentina, you have to say vos. What is the difference between tú and usted? Usted is the formal register of you. It means you, but in a formal setting or register. So you use usted to talk to your boss or to go to a job interview, or when we talk to the president or the king, the queen, or a VIP person, or a black tie event, or in certain cases also, you use usted to talk to elderly people, yeah, people that you want to show respect. What is the difference? ¿Cuál es la diferencia entre ustedes y vosotros? Ustedes significa, it means you all in Latin America. Yeah, it's only used in Latin America for you all. And vosotros is the form for you all, yes, to address a plural audience as you in Spain. So in Spain we use vosotros, in Latin America we use ustedes. Note that ustedes doesn't have a feminine form, yes, and vosotros does. So vosotros de femenino is vosotras. What happens if you use vosotros in Latin America? Nothing. People will assume that you learned Spanish in Spain. And if you use ustedes in Spain, people will assume that you learned Spanish or that you've been to Latin America. In Spain, they do use ustedes if they want to be extremely formal and respectful. It is used in certain contexts, but it's extremely formal in Spain. Muy bien, vamos a hablar de it. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about the personal pronoun it en español. As you can see here, we say that the Spanish version is going to be él o ella. Yes, he or she. So the thing is, in Spanish, we're going to have gender, set gender, even for things. Yeah? So obviously people and animals have dual genders, masculino and femenino, but things in Spanish, such as the table, the chair, the window, the book, they're going to have set genders. They're going to be either masculino or femenino. Yes. So in English, I know we call things as it. En español, we're going to call things he or she. Por ejemplo, la mesa is going to be femenino. El libro is going to be masculino. La puerta is going to be femenino. So, la mesa, la silla, the table and the chair and the door, la puerta, that we're going to say she. And for el libro, el coche, we're going to say él. So, when we talk about conjugation, you can see, for example, if I say in English, Ana, to be a teacher is not correct. We have to say Ana is a teacher. So that is what we are doing. We're conjugating the verb, we're putting the verb in the correct form for Ana to be performing this action, for Ana to be something. Ana is. In the same way, we cannot say Ana ser maestra. Yes, we have to say Ana es maestra. We need to change the verb and put it correlated with Ana. Something important to notice here is that in Spanish, we omit the subject in many occasions. We actually only mention it when we want to create contrast or for emphasis. But most Spanish speakers basically don't say yo soy. We basically say soy directly. We omit, we don't mention the subject. Why do we do this? Every single ending, every single form of the conjugated verb is slightly different. And what we are saying here is that the subject is already mentioned in the verb. Each personal pronoun, each subject will have a different form of the verb. And that is why it's redundant, if you want to think about it, to mention the subject, because it's already mentioned in the verb. If I say soy Ana, as you can see, it is not open to interpretation who are we talking about, because soy is not you, tú eres, él, ella es, nosotros somos. As you can see, soy can only be I. Can you see that? So because this person is already mentioned in the verb, we basically omit the subject in Spanish. Soy Ana cannot be any other person but yo. Muy bien, eso es todo por hoy. That is all for today. Thank you so much for watching this lesson and I will see you next time. Nos vemos. Adiós. Hasta luego.
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. I love to say that. Well, he's Diego.
Yeah. And he's Efraín.
Thank you. So today we will give you a top 10 of famous actors and actresses that do it well in Mexico.
Oh, very well. Yeah, so we hope that you enjoy this video.
Woo! So first, we're going to give you the top 5 actors that we chose, okay? And pay special attention, because at the end of this, we're going to ask you some questions, so you can see how much you understood of this topic. By the way, all of this will be in Spanish.
Yeah, exactly. But don't worry, because we truly encourage you not to use subtitles, but in case you need something, we will leave them right here.
Okay.
So, let's start with the first one. Vamos a empezar con el primero. Y bueno, este es mi actor favorito en lo personal y es Eugenio Derbez. Eugenio Derbez podremos considerarlo como un genio de la comedia mexicana. En la actualidad tiene 57 años, vive en Los Ángeles, pero nació y se crió y se desarrolló en México. Uh-huh. Él ha hecho bastantes películas de comedia principalmente. Por ejemplo, una de sus últimas películas que a mí me gustó mucho es Batteries Not Included. Así es como se llama la película en inglés, ¿no? Es No se aceptan devoluciones y es una historia muy bonita. Entonces, bueno, él es el que le da como tal el toque mexicano a las películas estadounidenses.
Ok, el siguiente actor es Demián Bichir. Él tiene una edad de 56 años. Es famoso porque trabajó para la serie The Bridge. Pero también fue nominado al Oscar con su papel en la película A Better Life.
Muy bien. Número 3, es un actor que está creciendo mucho últimamente en México y estamos hablando de Diego Boneta. Uh-huh. Diego Boneta tiene 28 años y pues bueno, se popularizó mucho por haber sido parte del elenco de una serie juvenil mexicana llamada Rebelde. Sin embargo, hace poco también salió en una de las series más populares en México, que fue la biografía de Luis Miguel. Él, por supuesto, interpreta a Luis Miguel.
Bien, el siguiente actor es Gael García. Ha trabajado en varias películas, como Amores Perros, El Crimen del Padre Amaro, entre otras. Pero también se volvió ganador del Globo de Oro por su actuación en la serie Mozart in the Jungle. Él tiene una edad de 40 años.
Bien, perfecto. El último actor que vamos a ver, y que también en lo personal es uno que me agrada bastante, es Diego Luna. Y bueno, Diego Luna tiene 39 años, y pues bueno, es muy amigo de Gael García Bernal. Diego Luna no únicamente es actor, sino también es productor, y pues bueno, se hizo muy famoso a partir de una de sus primeras películas, que fue Y tu mamá también, junto con Gael García Bernal, y bueno, a partir de ahí ha salido en muchas otras películas, tanto mexicanas como estadounidenses, como por ejemplo, salió en La Terminal con Tom Hanks, ¿ok? O también en Star Wars, también tuvo una aparición, un cameo en Star Wars. Okay, guys, now we're going to do the questions, so our questions, of course, will be in Spanish, and try to reply it in Spanish as well. Okay, well, at the end we will give you the answers. So, the first one. ¿Qué actor mexicano hizo un cameo en la película Star Wars Anthology?
Bien, la siguiente pregunta. ¿Qué edad
tiene de mi ambichir?
Pregunta número 3. ¿Qué tipo de serie es la serie Luis Miguel?
Siguiente pregunta. ¿Quién es el actor que es mejor amigo de Diego Luna?
Siguiente. ¿Qué género de películas generalmente filma Eugenio Derbez? Listo.
¿Y las respuestas?
Ah, cabrón. Sale.
1, 2, 3.
Ok, ahora vamos a decirles sus respuestas. Número 1, Diego Luna apareció, tuvo un cameo en la película Star Wars Anthology.
La edad de Demian Bichir es 56 años.
Luis Miguel es una serie biográfica.
El mejor amigo de Diego Luna es Gael García.
Ok, finalmente, Eugenio Derbez generalmente filma comedia.
La primera actriz de la que te vamos a hablar es Kate del Castillo. Ella tiene una edad de 46 años y es famosa por su papel protagonista en la serie La Reina del Sur, pero también en Dueños del Paraíso. Y sin duda también la vemos en la serie de Netflix Ingobernable. Ella es famosa por su relación dudosa con el famoso narcotraficante El Chapo Guzmán.
Exactamente. La siguiente actriz que vamos a ver es Aislinn Derbez. Y Aislinn Derbez es la hija del comediante Eugenio Derbez. Y bueno, a pesar de que no ha hecho demasiadas películas, en la actualidad está aumentando un poco su popularidad. Y pues bueno, ella tiene 32 años y ha aparecido también en muchas películas mexicanas, así como series. Una de sus series más famosas es La Casa de las Flores, que sale en Netflix.
Bien. La siguiente actriz se llama Carla Souza y ella es famosa por su papel en la película Nosotros los Nobles. Sin embargo, también destacó en Estados Unidos y México por su papel en la famosa serie How to Get Away with Murder. Carla Souza tiene una edad de 33 años.
Muy bien. Una que no podemos pasar desapercibida es Salma Hayek. Y Salma Hayek tiene una edad de 52 años. Nació en Veracruz, en el puerto de Veracruz, en México. Y pues bueno, es una de las pocas actrices que han sido nominadas al premio Oscar.
Wow.
Tiene muchísimas películas famosas, pero una que yo recuerdo en lo particular es, por supuesto, Spy Kids.
Bien, la siguiente actriz, que es mi favorita y estoy enamorado de ella, se llama Ana Claudia Talacón. Ella tiene una edad de 39 años, pero es famosa por su papel en la película El crimen del padre Amaro. Pero también la vemos como protagonista en otras películas como Arráncame la vida. Sin embargo, se habla mucho de ella, aunque ha dejado la actuación un poco de lado.
Well, now we will ask you some questions so we can see if you understood what we said.
¿Qué actriz, número uno, qué actriz es famosa por su relación con el narcotráfico?
Número 2. ¿Cuál es el parentesco entre Aislinn Derbez y Eugenio Derbez?
Número 3.
¿Por qué película se hizo famosa Ana Claudia Talancón?
4. ¿En dónde nació Salma Hayek?
5. ¿En qué serie ha participado Carla Souza?
¿A qué premio fue nominada Salma Hayek?
7. ¿Qué actriz es la favorita de Efraín?
Ok, ahora vamos a ver las respuestas a estas preguntas.
La actriz 1. La actriz Kate del Castillo es famosa por su relación y amistad con el Chapo Guzmán.
2. Aileen Derbez es la hija de Eugenio Derbez.
3. Ana Claudia Talancón es famosa por su papel en la película El crimen del padre Amaro.
Siguiente. Salma Hayek nació en Veracruz.
Respuesta de la pregunta 5. Carla Souza participó en la serie How to Get Away with Murder.
Siguiente. Salma Hayek fue nominada al premio Oscar.
Última pregunta. La actriz favorita de Efraín es Ana Claudia Talancón.
That's it for today, my friends from SmashBall101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please give it your thumbs up and please share it with other learners. And don't forget to subscribe to this beautiful channel because we will be uploading more and more and more content for you guys. So, if you have any suggestion of a topic that you want us to cover, please leave it in the comment sections down below. We will reply to it. So, see you soon, guys.
Hasta luego.
Hello there, my friends from SmashBall101.com. As you may know, my name is Diego.
And I'm Efraín.
And in today's video, we're going to cover a special verb in Spanish, and that's the verb ir. We're going to cover the conjugations, but also some special uses. So, enjoy this video. Woo!
So, the verb ir is considered irregular. So it doesn't follow the conventional rules for conjugation.
Yeah, that's correct. So the verb ir comes into play in many situations that are parallel to English uses. And so in this video, we're just going to cover the basic conjugation of this verb. And also we're going to give you some hints on the special usages of this verb. So let's see the first one, the first conjugation.
So the first way to conjugate the verb ir is presente del indicativo, and it is used for habits, okay? For example, yo voy a mi casa, yo voy al gimnasio, tú vas al gimnasio, tú vas a la tienda, okay? Yo voy, tú vas, él, ella, usted va, nosotros vamos, ellos, ellas van.
And ustedes van.
And ustedes van, se me está.
I forgot that. Now, remember this is especially important in this verb. This verb needs a preposition because we're talking about going to a place. So we mean toward, and that preposition is a. So that's why we will say yo voy al gimnasio o voy a la tienda. So we always need this preposition. Now, the second conjugation of this verb is pretty irregular, and we're talking about the pretérito, okay? So, in the pretérito, the good news is that the conjugation of the verb ir is the same as the conjugation of the verb ser. It's kind of strange, but yeah, it is the same. So, it will be yo fui, tú fuiste, él, ella, usted fue, nosotros fuimos, and ellos, ellas, ustedes fueron. Remember that we were talking about going to a place or towards
somewhere, we're going to use this preposition a. So, for example, ayer fui a la tienda y me encontré a Marta.
Marta.
Yeah.
So, the other way to conjugate the verb here is in the imperfecto.
Yeah.
So, the imperfecto is commonly used when you want to describe a past action or a fact that didn't have a definite end. That is, it can happen in the present. For example, yo iba a la escuela cada día. Diego y yo íbamos a la escuela todos los días. ¡Ahí nos conocimos!
¡Ya! Yeah.
Ah. ¡Ay, perdón! So, yo iba, tú ibas, él, ella, usted iba, nosotros íbamos, ellos, ellas, ustedes iban.
Very good, very good. Now, the next one is the participio of the verb ir. And the participio, remember, that is used especially in the perfecto tenses. So that is, we can use it in the pretérito perfecto, okay? Mm-hmm. Or in the pluscuamperfecto even. And the participio is just ido, okay? So, for example, yo he ido. Efraín, esta semana yo he ido al cine 5 veces.
¿Con Marta?
No, con Lucía. Oh. tú has ido, él ha ido. So, you see, it's the same. Nosotros hemos ido, ellos, ellas, ustedes han ido. And the pluscuamperfecto as well. So, había ido. Oh, Efraín. Ayer fui a un parque de diversiones. Hace mucho que no había ido a un parque de diversiones.
¡Qué bonito!
Ya, yeah, muy bonito.
So, the next one is the futuro indicativo. And it has the same root of the verb, ir. So, you use it to describe an action that is going to happen, okay? For example, mañana iré a ver a mi asesora de tesis. No me he titulado.
Él sí. Sí. Okay. So, okay. Well, the next one is that you can use the subjuntivo. And yeah, we know that the subjuntivo sometimes is a headache. We know it. But, well, we're going to cover very quickly the subjuntivo presente and subjuntivo pasado. So, in the subjuntivo presente, it is really, really, really irregular, the verb ir. And we can use it with quizás. Okay, so quizás plus the subjuntivo. And the subjuntivo is vaya, yo, vaya, quizás yo, vaya. Or tú, quizás tú, vayas. Mm-hmm. Quizás él, ella, usted, vaya. Quizás nosotros, vayamos. O quizás ellos, ellas, ustedes, vayan. Okay, so that's for the subjuntivo presente. So the next one is when we use the imperfecto subjuntivo in the past, okay? So, for example, for this we can use no esperaba que, okay? No esperaba que yo fuera, no esperaba que tú fueras, no esperaba que él, ella, usted fuera, no esperaba que nosotros fuéramos, no esperábamos que nosotros fuéramos a trabajar para SpanishPod101.com.
Wow!
Yes! Super cool! Or no esperaba que ellos, ellas, ustedes fueran. So you see, this is like the basic conjugation of the verb ir. Now we're going to cover some special usages of this verb.
One of the special usages of the verb ir is when you want to give a warning, okay? And remember that for a warning, you use the subjuntivo.
Yeah.
That we explained before. So, for example, when you want to say, don't go get yourself in trouble, you say, no te vayas a meter en problemas.
Mm.
For this situation, which is raining, don't go get yourself wet.
Yeah.
No te vayas a mojar, Diego.
No.
Está lloviendo.
No voy a salir.
Okay. When you want to give a warning to your friend, for example, this. Diego, no le vayas a decir a nadie mi secreto.
No. Tu secreto está a salvo conmigo.
Don't you tell my secret to anybody.
Yeah, that's correct. Good. Now, also, the verb ir is very handy when you want to talk about the future. Now, we do have a tense for the future that you need to know how to conjugate in each verb. But also, you can use the verb ir to mean the future. Mm-hmm. So, it's like in English when you say, I'm going to. It's the same in Spanish. So, it's voy a. So, for example, Efraín, ya tengo que irme, pero no te preocupes, voy a llamarte cuando llegue a mi casa. Okay?
Sí.
Sí. Or, for example.
Sí, por favor.
¿Qué vas a hacer mañana? Or, we can also, it's very handy when we want to speak about the past. It's once again, as in English, I was going to. I was going to. Okay, so, for example. Efraín, vi un curso de alemán y me iba a inscribir, pero ya no puedo por tanto trabajo que tengo ahora.
So, the next special use is vamos a, which means let's. For example, vamos al cine. Let's go to the cinema. Vamos a comer tacos. Vamos a
bailar.
Vamos a bailar.
Okay, so the next special use is with the verb ir and when we put a preposition. Yeah. So when we have the preposition por, ir por means go get something. Okay, like, Efraín, tenemos que irnos, deja, voy por las llaves. Okay, I'll go get the keys. Mm-hmm. Okay, but also, we have the special use of irle a. And irle a is like when you say in English to root for. Like, for example, a candidate in a political party or even a team. Okay, so, for example, yo en México... Yo le voy a los Pumas. Yeah, that's my team.
Congratulations. Okay, the next one is vaya, by itself, which means all right. Yeah. Okay? For example, I forgot, me olvidé de quitarme mi chamarra antes de grabar otra vez.
Vaya.
Another example. Diego, ¿cuántos tacos te comes en una noche?
Si tengo mucha hambre, 15.
¿15? Vaya, yo me como solamente 4. Y sin salsa, bueno, con poquita salsa para que pique.
Now, finally, with vaya, when you use vaya plus a noun, it is the same as in English when you say what a, okay? So, for example, Vaya plomero. Vaya plomero, no arregló muy bien mis tuberías y ahora tengo una gotera aquí arriba.
So that's it for today, my friends of SpanishPod101.com. If you like this video, give us your thumbs up and write your comments and share it with our learners. What else? I don't know. Anyway. Thank you for watching us. See you in our next video. Hasta luego.
Bye bye.
Hey, Diego.
Hey, Efra.
Oye, ¿conoces el restaurante de comida hindú?
No lo conozco.
Bueno, ¿conoces el barrio chino?
Sí, por supuesto, porque ahí fue donde conocimos a Omar.
Ah, vaya. Oí que se casó hace poco. ¿Sabes el nombre de su esposa?
Por supuesto. De hecho, la conocemos. Se llama Lucía.
Oh, cierto. Lucía era.
Sí.
Tiene una florería. ¿Sabes qué tipo de flores vende?
Sí, creo que vende gardenias, pero no conozco esas flores.
Okay, my friends from SpanishBall101.com, as you might know, my name is Diego.
And I'm Efraín.
And in this video, we're going to cover the verb conocer, as we said it a lot in this conversation. Mm-hmm. So, we hope that you enjoy this video.
So, let's talk about the verb conocer. The verb conocer could be translated to English as to know, but also to meet. The problem is here the verb to know, because it could be translated to Spanish as conocer, but also saber. So there is a problem, and we will cover the difference between conocer and saber. But keep this in mind. The verb conocer is an irregular verb in present, okay? That is, yo conozco, tú conoces, él, ella conoce, ustedes conocen, nosotros conocemos, ellos, ellas conocen.
Yeah, very good. So, now, what is the difference? When should we know when to use conocer and mm-hmm. when should we use saber? Well, as a rule of thumb, the difference is this. Conocer, you're going to use it in the sense of to be familiar with, and saber, you will translate it normally as to know. So, conocer, you will use it for proper nouns, or for names, or for places, okay? And saber, you use it for everything else. Basically, you use saber for facts, for information, okay? So, for example, if I want to speak about Paris, which is a place, conocer. If I want to speak about a lady called, I don't know, Sansa, you use conocer, okay? Why? Because we're using proper nouns here. So, ¿conoces a Sansa?
Sí, la conozco.
¿Conoces París?
No lo conozco.
Good. And saber, you use it for everything else. So, for example, ¿sabes lo que dice Sansa de ti?
No, para nada. No lo sé.
¿Sabes cómo son los parisinos?
Tampoco.
Good. You see? So, saber is mostly used for facts or for information, mm-hmm. and conocer is used for people, for places, or for proper nouns. Okay? Very easy the difference.
On the other hand, conocer could be translated as to meet. But in English, you can use to meet in different situations. So, this verb is kind of overworked, okay? In Spanish, we have other verbs to describe or to use for different situations. In this case, we have conocer, okay?
Yeah, exactly. So, conocer is going to be used rather when you meet someone, but only for the first time, mm-hmm. okay? So, you cannot, if you're going to continuously see this person, you cannot use this verb, but only the first time that you meet him or meet her. So, for example, yo conocí a Efraín mm-hmm. en la universidad, okay? Now, in English you can say, oh, I'm gonna meet my friend. So, but in Spanish, we need to use another verb. So, and I will divide it in two parts. Number one, the chance encounters, okay? So when you run into someone in an unexpected way, okay? So, when that happens, we don't use the verb conocer, no. We use instead the verb encontrarse con, okay? So, por ejemplo, esta mañana fui al gimnasio y me encontré con Sofía.
¡Ay, qué bien!
Sí, fue algo muy, muy gracioso. So, this situation was unexpected. I wasn't planning to meet Sofía today, but I ran into her. So, I'm not using conocí a Sofía, no. Because I already know her, okay? Mm-hmm. So, that's why me encontré con Sofía. Mm-hmm. However, if you're planning a get-together with someone or with a group of people, in that case, you will use the verb quedar con or quedarse de ver con or only ver. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Ver. So, in this case, you can use, for example, I have a family reunion later tonight, okay? So, esta noche, okay, me voy a encontrar con mi familia.
I'm gonna meet my family, okay? Or, esta noche veré a mi familia. It's the same verb. Or even, esta noche quedé con mi familia. Mm-hmm. So you will see you have three options for a planned get together, and none of them is conocer. Remember, conocer is only for the first time.
So now, let's check if you understood what we saw in this lesson.
Yeah, why not? Let's do it with a couple of examples so you can choose the most suitable verb to use. Okay?
Mm-hmm. So, number one. Do you know how much is 2 plus 2?
¿Sabes cuánto es 2 más 2? This is for a fact. That's why we use saber.
Mm-hmm. Now, number 2. Do you know Momo's tail?
¿Conoces el cuento de Momo? And in this case, we use conocer because we are talking about proper names. In this case, Momo. O el cuento de Momo.
Now, number 3. I will meet Romina tomorrow.
Quedé de verme con Romina mañana. Or veré a Romina mañana. O quedé con Romina mañana. Mm-hmm. And this is used for, because you already know your plans, okay? You have your plan get together. That's why you're going to use quedar de verse con, quedar con, or ver a.
Number 4. I met Omar 2 days ago in the downtown.
Okay. Me encontré con Omar ayer en el centro. And in this case, you use me encontré because you are using it as a synonym of running to something unexpected. That's why me encontré con Omar.
Mm-hmm.
Or me encontré a Omar.
Now, number 5.
Yeah.
Okay. I met Alfredo for the first time in high school.
Conocí a Alfredo en la preparatoria. And of course you're using it because, well, even in English you use it for the first time. So that means that that was the very first time that you met Alfredo.
Okay, a plus one. Well,
another one.
Okay, I can't tomorrow. I will meet my cousin in the morning.
Mm-hmm. No puedo mañana. Quedé de verme con mi primo. And this is because it's once again something that was planned. Okay?
Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. Thank you for watching us. Hope that you like this video. And if so, please give us your thumbs up, write your comments down below, and share this with other learners, please, so we can get to know more people, okay? Please subscribe to this channel and see you in our next video.
See you guys.
Hasta luego.
Hello, my friends from SpanishPod101.com. My name is Diego.
And I'm Efraín.
And in this video, we're going to check a very interesting topic. And this topic is the difference between qué and cuál. So, enjoy this video.
Woo!
Okay, guys, so the words que and cual could be seen as linking words, that is, relative pronouns. So, in this case, the words que and cual are without the accent mark. However, the words can also be seen as interrogative words. In such case, the words que and cual have an accent mark. So, in this video, we're going to focus rather on the interrogative words. And why? Because in English, you can normally translate the word que as what and the word cual as which. However, the difference is not that simple because there are some situations that both of them can be used, but there are also other situations where one needs to be used over the other.
So, we're going to see those situations in this video. Let's start with the first one.
Okay, the first one is that you can use que or cual in order to suggest a choice within a group. Okay? And the structure for cual will be this. Question mark, cual, plus verb or preposition. But bear this in mind, the preposition will usually be the word de. Okay? For example, Diego, ¿cuál de estas tres ciudades es tu favorita? Monterrey, Guadalajara o Ciudad de México.
Ah, definitivamente mi ciudad favorita es Ciudad de México.
Muy bien. ¡Ay! Otro ejemplo. Diego, ¿cuál de estos colores es tu favorito? ¿El rosa, el azul o el naranja?
Yo creo que el rosa.
¡El rosa!
What? I hate you.
Okay. Let's continue. ¿Por qué? The structure will be this. Question mark. ¿Qué? Plus noun. Okay? So you can say, Diego, ¿qué ciudad es tu favorita? ¿Guadalajara, Ciudad de México o Monterrey?
Ciudad de México.
Muy bien. And they mean the same. They have the same meaning. Once again. Diego, ¿qué color es tu favorito?
El rosa, por supuesto.
Okay, guys, so the next situation is that you can use the word que or cual plus a verb to express the preference. And we have certain verbs that express the preference of something. We're going to tell you four of these verbs. Number one, you can use the verb gustar. Number two, of course, the verb preferir. Number three, you can also use the verb querer. And finally, you can use the verb desear. These four verbs could be used with this form, which is que plus verb or cual plus verb. Let's see some examples of it. So I can ask Efraín, Efraín, ¿qué prefieres? ¿La comida mexicana o la comida china?
La mexicana.
Perfecto. I can also ask Efraín, Efraín, ¿qué te gustaría comprar?
una compu.
Bien, perfecto. Now, let's imagine this last situation. I can ask Efraín, imagine that we have here a set of options of computers, and I can ask Efraín, Efraín, ¿cuál te gustaría comprar?
Una MacBook.
Good. Now, imagine the former situation when I ask Efraín, ¿qué prefiere? So, I'm hungry, and here we have the option of comida china, comida mexicana, comida hindú, comida rusa, bla, bla, bla. So, I can ask Efraín, Efraín, ¿cuál prefieres?
La comida rusa.
Good. So, you see, here we have two different ways for asking for the same, which is the preference of something. Now, bear in mind this. Que is going to be used when you want general information about something. And cual is when you have a special set that you can see. You have it in front of you. But at the end, the result is the same.
Good. Okay. So the next one is, you use que in order to ask for definitions or in order to get an explanation of something. For example, Diego, ¿qué es el amaranto?
El amaranto. No tengo idea.
Okay, we have this explanation of amaranto in another video.
In another video. Yeah. Go check it out.
Okay. Diego, ¿qué hace un abogado?
Okay, un abogado defiende a un culpable en un juicio.
Bien. Diego, ¿qué es esto?
Eso es amaranto. Es una alegría. Hecha de amaranto.
Ajá. So, well, that's it.
Okay, guys. So, the next one is when you use the verb que plus a verb in the conditional tense. Now, you cannot use cual with the conditional tense.
So let's see one example. Remember that the conditional tense is the with the ending ia. Mm-hmm. So let's see one example. So Efraín, mañana tengo una entrevista de trabajo y no sé cómo vestirme. ¿Tú qué te pondrías?
Definitivamente me pondría una linda camisa, una corbata delgada y un pantalón de vestir que me quede bien y a la medida.
Perfecto. So, now, bear in mind this. As we previously said, in this, you can also use cual as long as you use the preposition de. So, if you paid close attention to our previous examples, you can see that I can also tell Efraín. Imagine that here I have a set of options of different clothes. So I can ask Efraín. Efraín, aquí tengo algunas opciones.
Good.
¿Cuál de estas opciones te pondrías?
La opción número 2.
Good. I don't know which one is that, but it looks nice.
Okay. The next one, you can use this structure. Question mark, ¿cuál plus verb? And question mark. In order to ask or to ask for general information. Okay. For example, Diego, ¿cuál es tu número de celular?
Mi número de celular es 55 27 23 44 and I will hide the two last digits. 90.
Why?
Okay, so
the next one. ¿Cuál es tu número favorito?
Mi número favorito es el 7.
Nice. Remember, it is the same when you use que plus noun. Okay? With this example, ¿qué número es tu favorito?
Mi número favorito es 7.
¿Cuál es tu número favorito?
7.
¿Qué es tu número favorito?
7.
¿Cuál es?
7.
That's it for today, friends of SpanishPod101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. Please share this video with other learners. And if you like this video, write your comments down below and like this one. Follow this channel, SpanishPod101.com, of course. And see you in our next video.
See you guys.
Hasta luego.
Una, dos, tres. Hey there, friends of SpanishPod101.com. This day is a special day because we have a great lesson for you. Three ways to say but in Spanish with some exercises at the end. Right, Diego?
That's correct. So, enjoy the video.
Woo!
Okay, guys. So, the word but in English, you use it all the time. However, in Spanish, we have three different words for conveying this simple word but. We need to keep in mind that the word in English but can be sometimes substituted for the words except, for however, but also but rather. So these three words are different in English, but you can use only the word but for conveying the three of them. In Spanish, it is not possible. We need to break it down so you can have a much clearer idea on how to use it properly. So let's start with the first one.
Okay, the first one is pero, and it is the most common but you are going to find, and it is easy to master. Okay, let's check an example. I like pizza, but I don't like sushi. Okay, when the first statement doesn't contradict the second one, or when the second one doesn't contradict the first one. Okay? Let's check this example in Spanish. Me gusta la pizza, pero no me gusta el sushi. Good. Okay. Still a bit confused? Let's check it down again. The first example. I like pizza, but I don't like sushi. If we break this sentence into two, and you can replace the but with however, and start the second sentence. For example, I like pizza, however, I don't like sushi. When you can replace the but with however, then you should use pero. Okay? Let's check it down. Let's check some examples in Spanish.
So, tengo un coche, pero no lo manejo. I have a car, but I don't drive it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I have dogs, but I don't have cats. Tengo perros, pero no tengo gatos.
Okay, so now you can replace the word pero with a much more formal way for saying it. And this word is sin embargo.
Mm-hmm.
So they are interchangeable, okay? So for example, I can say, Efraín, son las 3 de la tarde, pero, or, sin embargo, no hace sol.
Okay.
Pretty easy.
Another one. Mi playera es azul. Sin embargo, ya está deslavada.
It doesn't look blue anymore.
Doesn't look blue anymore.
Okay, guys. Now, let's see another word for conveying but. And this word is sino. And learning sino is rather simple. Let's see why. So, in the previous case with pero, we have two sentences.
Uh-huh.
The first one and the second. And the second one didn't really contradict the first one. But in sino, the second one is going to contradict the first part. Now, there's a catch here. Because the first sentence has to have the word no, and then you use sino. I would say that the best way for learning something is by making examples. So let's see one. Efraín, no estamos en tu casa, sino en la mía.
Mm-hmm.
Efraín, we are not at your house, but mine. So you see here, you're using the word in English, but in Spanish, you wouldn't be able to use pero. It doesn't make sense. So that's why you need to use sino. Now, a good way for remembering this is that if you can replace but rather, you use sino. We are not at your house, but rather mine. Okay, guys? So let's see one more example. No me gusta el calor, sino el frío. I don't like the heat, but rather the cold.
Mm-hmm. Así es.
Good. Now, the second part of sino is that sino can also take a conjugated verb. But when you use a conjugated verb, you need to use sino que. Okay? You can use sino all by itself when you have a not conjugated verb or an adjective or a noun. For example, Efraín, a mí no me gusta caminar, sino correr.
Okay.
Or a noun. For example, yo no amo a los perros. No, sino a los gatos. Yeah. Or also an adjective. A mí no me gustan las chicas morenas, sino rubias.
Mm.
So if you're one, please add me on Instagram.
No.
Okay. Now the third one is you can use sino que plus the conjugated verb. So for example, mis padres no se quedaron en casa, sino que fueron al cine.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Okay, guys, so hopefully this is much clearer now. And now we have in English one expression that is not only but also. And in this expression, you also use sino. Okay, so let's see how this works. The structure in Spanish will be no solo something, then sino también something. For example, I not only like tortas, but also tamales and tacos. No solo me gustan las tortas, sino también los tamales y los tacos, por supuesto. Okay.
Okay. Now, we have the next set of words. Salvo, menos, and excepto. You use these words when stating a contradiction to a general rule. Let's make it clear. You can use but and except, sorry, but and except as synonyms, okay? So when they are synonyms, then you can use salvo, menos, and excepto. Let's see an example. Everyone but John left. Now we have three ways to say this in Spanish. Todos, excepto Juan, se fueron. Todos, salvo Juan, se fueron. Todos, menos Juan, se fueron. Okay? And although they have different definitions, menos, salvo, and except, they mean the same thing in Spanish. Okay? Let's check another example with Diego.
Sure. Yo trabajo todos los días, excepto el domingo.
Mm-hmm.
Although today is Sunday, actually. It doesn't make sense. Okay, so now guys, let's do some exercises so these three ways for conveying the word but are much clearer to you. Okay guys, so let's start. Okay guys, so the instructions for this exercise are rather simple. So we're going to say the sentence in English and then we encourage you to pause the video and try to figure out how to say it in Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
Then I will say the sentence in Spanish just to check if you got it correct. Okay guys, just remember that you can use these sentences with pero, with sino, sino que, or with menos, salvo, or excepto.
Excepto.
Okay, uh-huh. So let's start.
Okay, the first one. I have travels to all the countries in America but Canada.
He viajado a todos los países de América excepto, salvo, menos, Canadá.
Okay, that's not yours, but rather mine.
Eso no es tuyo, sino mío.
He wants coffee, but he doesn't want sugar.
Él quiere café, pero no quiere azúcar.
We didn't just drink tequila, but mezcal.
No solo tomamos tequila, sino también mezcal.
Mm-hmm. We are not Colombians, but Mexicans.
No somos colombianos, sino mexicanos.
Very good. Everyone went to the party, but Romina.
Todos fueron a la fiesta, excepto, salvo, menos, Romina.
I like everything about her, but her attitude.
Me gusta todo de ella, excepto, salvo, menos, su actitud.
Okay. I like every flavor, but vanilla.
Me gustan todos los sabores, excepto, salvo, menos, la vainilla.
I'm in the restaurant, but I don't see you.
Estoy en el restaurante, pero no te veo.
Okay, everyone but Dave said yes.
Todos, excepto, salvo, menos, David, dijeron que sí.
I'm not angry, but rather sad.
No estoy enojado, sino triste.
That's it.
That's it for today, my friends of SpanishBall101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please give it your thumbs up and share this video with other learners. And of course, guys, please leave us your comments, your opinions, your thoughts in the comment section right below. And of course, see you in our next video, guys.
Hasta luego.
Want to speed up your language learning? Take your very first lesson with us. You'll start speaking in minutes and master real conversations. Sign up for your free lifetime account. Just click the link in the description.